It's been said, this is kind of important to me. It's been said that how we teach is what we teach. How we teach is what we teach. So what am I really teaching you? Am I teaching you urgent care medicine? Yeah, I guess. I guess that's why you're here, but I guess ultimately I'm trying to teach you how to think, how to process content. And like knowing the right antibiotic for sinusitis is the easy part. It's how do we think about sinusitis? How do we think about the distribution and the stewardship of antibiotics? But most importantly, guys, I hope I'm teaching you how to stay out of trouble. Urgent care is risky, okay? Now, if you've ever worked on an ambulance, if you've ever been a paramedic or an EMT, you know the golden rule of being a paramedic or EMT is scene safety, okay? Meaning, if you're a paramedic and you pull up on a car accident, the worst case scenario is not that the person in the car dies. That's not the worst case scenario. Worst case scenario is you die trying to take care of that patient. That's the worst case scenario. And that same principle applies to our practice of urgent care medicine, guys. Do you understand that if you are getting your butt kicked day in and day out by lawsuits, complaints, like if you're having bad outcomes, you can't survive in an urgent care. Urgent cares are dangerous. So if there were six different things that I want you to know about mindset, what are the six proper mindsets that I believe you should have if you work in urgent care medicine? And I have them right here. So what are the six things that I really hope you leave the conference with? Let's talk about number one. Number one is stack the deck. What does stack the deck mean when it comes to taking care of sick people? Colleagues, it means stacking the deck means it gives you an unfair advantage. Do we agree? Like, if you stack the deck with aces and you're playing poker, you'd get an unfair advantage. I am saying stack the deck. So, how do we stack the deck? Risk factors. We have to know what risk factors lead to the disease that we're thinking about. And, ladies and gentlemen, to an absolutely huge degree, it's what are your arterial risk factors and your venous risk factors. Every single patient that you deal with that has chest, pulmonary, or belly symptoms, you better think, are they risky? Diabetic smokers are very risky. Diabetic smokers are risky. Women on birth control pills are risky. Have the appropriate degree of concern. You guys heard me yesterday talk about that farmer that I didn't pick up his ischemic heart disease that ended with a heart transplant. Complaining non-complainers are risky. So I'm suggesting do not walk into every single room thinking every patient is the same. They have different risk profiles, okay? A 10-year-old with a cough is not the same as an 80-year-old with a cough. Like, I know you know that, but I just want you to apply at a better level. When you walk into a room, stack the deck and think of risk factors, okay? What's the second thing I want you to know? A bias to bad, a bias to bad. What does that mean? I want you to think the patient that you're seeing is a catastrophe until you prove otherwise. Don't have a bias towards benign. Ah, I'm sure this is nothing. You know what? If you say, I'm sure this chest pain is nothing, you're going to be right 95 out of 100 times, but you're going to be wrong 5 times out of 100 times too. Oh, this cough is nothing. Yeah, you're right. 95, 98% of the time, it's going to be nothing. 2 times out of 100, it's going to be a catastrophe. And if you get in the habit of a bias for benign, you're going to have a bias towards benign. You're going to be real casual when you need to amp it up. I teach have a bias towards bad. And you know what that means in urgent care? It means you're going to have to work more people up and you're going to have to transfer more people. And that takes time and discernment. It means you're going to have to transfer a lot of soft cases, and that just takes some time, but that's still what I recommend. What's number three? What's number three in the mindset of taking care of acutely sick people? Think of Pete. All of your documentation is really going to ultimately come down to how does Pete, the plumber, the guy on the jury, think about your care? Because, ladies and gentlemen, there are two different standards of care. You have a legal standard of care, but you also have a standard of caring. So, the legal standard of care, would a like-minded provider in the same situation do the same thing? And really, what does that mean? It means whatever your attorney can prove. That's all it means. But what about a standard of caring? That truly comes down to does Pete think you cared? That's really, and how are they going to know? How is Pete going to know your essence and your character? How is Pete going to know if you cared about a patient? Because that is very important to Pete. Are you a cold-hearted son of a bee? You know, you just someone who wants money and you don't care about people? Is that who you are? Because that's who the plaintiff wants you to look like. Or are you someone that deeply cares about people and that's why you got into this field? How is Pete going to know that? Two things. Your chart and the things you say on the chart. And how you present in court. Okay? Colleagues, it can go a very long way giving a positive, affirming adjective about your patients in the chart. Friendly male, okay? And you may want to just slip in a nice adjective about somebody. Cooperative, nice, friendly, something. It can't hurt you, it can only help you, okay? So I want you to document your discharge instructions so Pete thinks you are a caring person. What's number four, John? I'm encouraging you to transfer your charts from a negligence chart to a judgment chart. How do we communicate a judgment in our thinking? And that is the word because. And guys, because means document your medical decision making. Okay? Just tell me what you were thinking. If you have someone with a laceration, you send them home and a piece of glass pops out of that wound a month later and the wound needs to be explored in the OR. Are you negligent about a foreign body being retained? And the answer is, it depends on what you did to work it up. If you just said laceration, I sutured it, have a nice day. If you did that, you were negligent. You didn't even think about a foreign body. But if you put in your chart, mechanism of glass, I transilluminated it, I explored the wound, I do not see a foreign body, and I looked for it. Okay, don't get me wrong, an x-ray would be the best thing to do. We'll talk about that tomorrow under wound care, but I'm still saying you want to document your judgment. So when it comes to chest pain, shortness of breath, headaches, why are you sending the migraine headache home? Like, why isn't that headache a subarachnoid hemorrhage? Like, how are you going to document? It's not it's subarachnoid hemorrhage considered, but because this patient has had these frequently, she says it's the same headache she always has, just the Imitrex didn't work today, no acute onset. Therefore, subarachnoid hemorrhage is very low on the differential, not worthy of further workup. Now, hold on, guys. I know I'm being more wordy, and you wouldn't be this wordy in your chart, but I'm telling you, every single chart that you see, what are the high-risk features of that? Someone falls and hurts their arm. What's the high-risk feature of an arm injury? The big one is a scaphoid fracture. Did you miss a navicular fracture? Okay. What's the next thing that I want you to be able to think about when it comes to taking care of acute people? And that is system one versus two, system two thinking. System one versus system two thinking. So what does that mean? Colleagues, remember, you have two systems of thinking. System one is passive and it's lazy. Okay? System two is incredibly active. Okay? You know system one thinking. If you ever jumped in your car and you were driving towards work, but it was a Saturday, you weren't working, but you got off in the exit to go to work accidentally because you just forgot. You got in a habitual system one. Oh, you're going to the mall, not to work today, but you forgot about it. Okay? So once you become experienced and you get some flow, you can now do a whole day of work and not have it fatigue you because most of the day is in system one. A really, really, really good clinician has their sensitivity set very, very light. So if something is abnormal, you stop and say, wait, why is this patient tachycardic? This doesn't make sense. I better look at it with a vigorous, enthusiastic mindset to find a problem. Truly, guys, I think that's been one of my greatest qualities as a clinician. I just didn't take things for granted. Like if something didn't seem right, I investigated it and I found stuff. Last thing is, be liked, be likable, be likable, be likable. And we're going to talk about that on day four, but I do want to share with you a mnemonic on how to be likable, okay? I am a really, really big fan of thinking and how we think. I'm a huge fan of delusions and denials and biases that we have. I'm a huge fan of thinking about my own thinking. Okay, that's called metacognition. Metacognition is to think about your own thought process. So when a medical error happens, like, okay, you misread an EKG. I want to know, why did you misread the EKG? Are you just incompetent, or did you look at the EKG and you already had a bias, so you didn't look at it right? Okay? So part of that is studying influence. How do we influence others? How do we persuade and influence others? And there's a guy named Robert Cialdini who wrote a book called Influence. He's kind of the godfather of influence. He did a bunch of social science studies. He's from Arizona. I actually went and met him, and I went through one of his conferences, and I've lectured on this topic. So the question then becomes, is there anything that we can do to become more likable? And the answer is yes. So in Robert Cialdini's book, Influence, he said there are five triggers of influence. These are the tools that make people like us more. And I'm going to ask you, as I show you these, can any of these you use starting today at a higher level? Because the facts are, when patients like you, every part of your life is better. The fact is, when your staff like you, when the nursing staff likes you, every part of your life is better. Okay? Every part of your life is better. I'll not forget, I went into an exam room and there was a young teenage daughter and a mom, okay? And so I kind of bond with mom and daughter. I make some jokes. I do a non-medical gesture. Like I just do the right things. I joked with mom, okay? And what happened is mom liked me. We just hit it off, right? And I remember I ordered a dose of amoxicillin and I was going to prescribe a prescription for whatever infection they had. And the nurse comes to me freaking out. Oh my gosh, what? The kid's allergic to penicillin. Okay? And I gave him a dose of amoxicillin. Oh, shit. Okay, so I got to go in the room and immediately go, listen, ma'am, we gave your daughter a dose of amoxicillin. She's allergic to penicillin. And immediately I had to deal with the potential anaphylactic reaction, which it was nothing. It was no big deal. But now we just gave an antibiotic that a girl was allergic to. And I had to say to the mom, I am deeply sorry this happened and I take complete responsibility for it. This is my fault. And I don't think this is a little thing. I'm very bothered by this. And I said that I'm going to write a letter so my supervising doctor knows that I made this medical error and that this medical error goes in my record. So I don't think this is a little thing. I think it's a really big thing. And you know what she said to me? She said, I don't want you to do that. I don't want you to get in trouble. Just because she liked me. Okay, so being likable makes every part of your life better. So what are the five triggers of likability, John? The mnemonic I teach is CASTA. You want to cast a likable shadow. Cast a likable shadow. So what does a C stand for? The C stands for compliments. Compliment your patients. As often as you can, compliment them. Okay? Just compliment them. Have a very low filter to just say, good for you. You've been taking Motrin. Good. That's fantastic. That's an excellent. You're taking good care of yourself. Just look for ways to compliment your patients. Okay. And just so you know, in the influence literature, flattery works. Okay. Meaning that if you give an insincere compliment, it still increases your likability. Like I remember that particular daughter and mom, when I walked in the room, she might have been teenagers. Okay. She must have been 14-ish or so. I walked in the room. Hi, my name's John. I'm John. And I said, oh, it's clearly your sister brought you in today. No, I'm the mom. Well, you just look so young. I thought you were a sister. No. Did she like it? Of course she liked it. Was it flattery? Yes, it was flattery. So, colleagues, compliment your patients as often as you can. It increases your likability. A is attractive, okay? If the literature shows if you are perceived as being attractive physically by the other person, you will have more likability. Okay, that just makes sense, right? If you doubt if that's true, look at the Pfizer drug reps. Next time you see them, ask, how did they get their job? Okay, they all look like supermodels, okay? It wasn't their GPA, I guarantee it. The S stands for similarity. If you have something in common with another person, we're going to get along better. So if you can find something you have in common with your patients, you're going to bond with them more. So how do we figure that out? We ask questions, okay? if you can take a minute or two to just have a conversation with that person about something other than medicine, you know what's going to happen? You may not be able to see a patient or two in your shift. Instead of going through 28 patients, you may only go through 26 patients. But you know what else is going to happen? You're going to make a lot of good relationships. Lawsuits are going to go down. Your compliment letters are going to go up. And you know, in urgent care medicine, one of the greatest compliments that you can possibly get is when a patient says, "Do you take patients outside of the urgent care? Because I'm looking for a doctor and I really like you." If you're getting that every once in a while, that's what's up. "I like you so much, I want you to take care of my whole body, not just my cut, not just my dental pain. Something about you I like so much, I want you to take care of me." Okay, that's what I'm talking about. T is team. Okay, guys, as often as we can, we want to get on the patient's team. Too often, patients feel like it's the patient against the institution. It's me against this urgent care. You guys just want to make money from me. If you come into the room and your mindset is, no, it's you and I against the institution. I'm on your team. Now, if you think about it, and if you look at data, what are the two biggest complaints that patients have based on press gainy data? Two biggest complaints are poor quality communication and time delays. That's the biggest reason why people complain, okay? So how do we heal? How do we work to fix poor quality communication? You got to work at it. Like, it takes some practice. Ask questions. Show some interest in the patient as a person, not just as a laceration. Show a little bit of interest. Ask some questions. Guys, I've precepted 50 students in my career. I can tell you that the best PAs, I can teach anybody medicine. That's easy. It's hard to teach bedside manner. And some of the best students that I have ever precepted, they were waitresses before they got into medicine. And then they knew how to talk to people. They knew that their communication, their smile, their presence would increase their tips. So if they came into work, you know, with empathy, gregarious, helpful, their tips went up 20%. So all of a sudden they realized, wow, that's an effective way to get along with people. So when it comes to poor quality communication, it just takes practice. Now, time delays. How do we fix time delays? We really can't. Like, we can't shorten up the visit so much so because we're dealing with patient expectation. Okay? So if I said to you, what's a long time to you? Well, what do you mean by that? Because it's all about, if I said, what's a long time to you? It's completely subjective. Long time for what? Long time for a shower? 20 minutes is a long time for a shower. For me, 5 minutes is a long time for a shower. Okay? What's a long time? Holding your breath. Okay, 3 minutes is a long time holding your breath. So what's a long time waiting in an urgent care? It's completely subjective. It's completely subjective. Okay? Some people want to be seen right now. They think it's McDonald's. So just so you know, the only way, the best way to help with time is overestimate it. You got to overestimate time. You got to change their perception. You got to make their perception of time seem long and then come shorter than that. That's the only way you're going to fix that problem. Okay, but picture this. You walk into a room and a patient's red-lighted because they waited too long. Their perception is they waited way too long in this urgent care. Now they're pissed off and they're fired up. And guys, I don't know where you work right now, but some of the urgent cares are fee-for-service kind of urgent cares. You don't want to piss people off because they won't come back, okay? And then you're not going to have a job. So when you walk into a room of a patient who is redlining because of time, get on their team, okay? Don't fight them on time. Get on their team and just say, listen, man, I apologize for your delay. Like, the wait here, it was a long time and I apologize for it. I promise you I was really busy, but I apologize for the wait, but I'm here now and I want to take good care of you. So it's you and I against the facility. It's not us against you. Get on the patient's side. So the enemy is the facility. It's the nature of what we do. It's not me because I'm on your side. I'm your advocate. Do you know who does this all the time? Car salesmen, right? They come to you and they're like, listen, I think we can do better than this. I'm going to go in on your behalf and we're going to get this car at a lower price. We're going to get you the floor mats for free. I got you. Okay. And then we like them better. Get on their team. And the last A stands for associations. Associations, associations, associations. The bottom line is this, guys. If I work at an emergency room close by you and you're at an urgent care 10 miles away. So Courtney, who's going into work today, she calls me and says, hey, John, I'm sending in a patient. And I don't know who Courtney is at all. I never met her before. I just know she's a name on the phone. She just calls me and she gives me this really great sign out. She's responsive. She's responsible. She gives a great sign out. She sends over the appropriate letters. Everything she said is to the T. She is accurate. Now, you know what happens is I'm judging Courtney to some degree because medicine is medicine. I need to know who I can trust. Can I trust Courtney? She sent in a patient. Her trust level is 99%. Excellent. She calls me next week. Hey, John, it's Courtney from the urgent care. Listen, I got another patient I got to send over to you. Yada, 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 yada. She gives me a really good sign out. And the patient comes over. It's exactly what she told me it was going to be. And trust level 100%. She sends over another patient. Trust level is 97%. Okay, to me now she has a halo. I like Courtney. That urgent care Courtney, I like her. She's accurate, she's precise, she's concise. So next thing you know, if she sends me a patient, she completely misses the bet on it. She's off. She just wasn't close and her trust level was a 60. Well, the bottom line is she already has a halo in my eyes. So I judge her way lighter. So the halo effect, we are associated with first impressions often. And that means, ladies and gentlemen, at your urgent care, wherever you work, politics are important. How the supervising docs and the primary care docs think of you is important. Because when something goes wrong on a chart, they're often going to rate you best to a huge degree on the halo effect. Do you have a halo in their eyes? So if you don't have a strong relationship with the peripheral doctors and the healthcare providers, you might want to work on it, okay? You may want to just try to work on those relationships. That's my advice. I found that when I was well-liked, big problems go away. In my career, when I didn't care about that and I had some, you know, high-friction relationships, little things became big things very quickly. Cool? We'll talk about this a little more later. Welcome to day two. Folks, what you just saw was an excerpt from our urgent care conference. See, a big thing about what we do at CME for Life, yeah, our slogan is maximize your mind, but also understand that how we teach is what we teach. How we teach is what we teach. So when we teach urgent care medicine, we're not just teaching you the right antibiotic for otitis media. We're teaching you how to think. How to think about the antibiotic that you select for otitis media. Or how you approach a chest pain or shortness of breath. Measurable increases in confidence and competence. So if this intrigues you, if you work urgent care medicine and you want to up your confidence and competence, consider investing in our urgent care CME program. Okay, it will measurably increase your confidence and competence. In any of the CME programs you buy from CME for Life, it doesn't really leverage your behavior, return it, okay? Our whole passion is to help you maximize your mind. How we teach is what we teach. We teach you critical thinking so you have the right answer, so you know how to keep yourself out of trouble when there's a patient in front of you. So consider investing in our CME for Life program on urgent care medicine. Understand, we know that the best way for you to learn is on your timeline, the way best serving you. So we do offer CME programs with gift cards so you can buy an iPad or a tablet so you can learn at work. You can learn on how it's good for you to learn. So consider investing in your education